Hello and let's talk about the Vetrivel Yatra in Tamil Nadu. This Yatra, which is going to be organized by the BJP in honor of the Hindu god Murugan, who is also known as Kartikeya, was scheduled to start tomorrow, that's the 6th of November. However, today the government told the Madras High Court, and this is a state government, that permission had been denied to hold the Yatra. Now, the BJP had planned this elaborate month-long Yatra from November 6th to December 6th across various districts, at a time when the COVID-19 pandemic continues to rage. Yesterday, 2,500 cases were reported in the state. But nonetheless, the BJP had made elaborate plans and the Yatra was scheduled to end on December 6th, the anniversary of the demolition of the Babri Masjid. Now, the BJP has really failed to gain a foothold in the state despite trying a number of ways to polarize voters and raise issues of Hinduism and the religion. And this seems yet another one of those strategies. To talk more about what exactly the BJP's game plan was, what the relationship between the BJP and the current AIADMK government is, and the overall political situation in the state, we have with us NewsClick's Neelambaran.
Thank you, Neelambaran, for joining us. So the news, of course, is that the permission to conduct this Vetrivel Yatra has been denied. And the BJP was, of course, looking forward to this. But could you first maybe take us through what exactly was the BJP's plan when it came to holding this Yatra? And the more important question, why was it even considered at this point of time?
So, with the elections due in the state in another 6 months, the BJP was trying hard to sell itself because the BJP has no traditional hold in the state. They were unable to, you know, win elections on their own in the recent couple of decades. Only in 2001, they have few MLAs, and again with Alliance, they had a few MPs from the states. So, apart from that, on their individual strength, they were unable to establish themselves as a huge force in the state. So, and the recent controversy on the, the religious song, which is related to Lord Murugan, came in handy for them. A YouTube channel was, explaining the contents of the lyrics, and they had nothing to, they created nothing of their own, to be honest. They were quoting from the books, and the BJP took this as a chance to promote themselves as the representatives of the majority religion here, as they do elsewhere in the country. So this was elections due. The relation between ADMK and BJP was a little bit of, going off the, they were not comfortable with each other in the recent times. So they again wanted to project themselves as a huge force in the state. So they decided to hold this Yatra for a 1 month period starting tomorrow, scheduled to start tomorrow, which has been now denied permission. So the concluding date also, was criticized because it was planned to be concluding on December 6th, which we know what is the importance of that date as well. But with the pandemic on the other side, the health minister a couple of days ago stated that the second or third wave can be prevented only with the support of the people. So that condition being taken into consideration, the government has denied permission. They have submitted that to the High Court of Madras today. So the only the projection of themselves being a huge party, a huge force in the state, is the only aim of the BJP, and it has nothing to do with the demands of the people, which has been raised over the past several months in the state.
Absolutely right, and in this context, it's kind of important to also note that, like you mentioned as well, this is planned in between the pandemic. And it's a really strange time to schedule something like a Yatra, which involves a lot of travel across various regions. But that said, you mentioned another point, which is very interesting about the ADMK and the BJP's relationship. So could you elaborate a bit more on that? We just recently discussed the fact that the current chief minister, Edappadi Palaniswamy, who's known as EPS, is now going to be the face of the AIADMK again. And BJP has clearly been involved in the ADMK for quite some time in various ways. So what is currently the equation that is going on?
Yeah, before going to that particular, the relationship between the BJP and ADMK, I would clarify on the path which was planned by the BJP for this Yatra. They were planning to connect the six important stations which were meant for the worshipping Lord Murugan here, the six abodes of Lord Murugan, starting from Tirupathur in the northern part, to Trishandur in the south. So they were trying to connect all these six locations to different parts of the state in which, as you mentioned, it requires a lot of manpower. They were planning to mobilize a huge number of people in these meetings and all those things. So definitely it is not the right time to take out such an yatra, you know, putting into risk the lives of people who are already suffering so much in Tamil Nadu.
Right.
And coming to the second part, the relationship between BJP and ADMK is kind of a strained relationship of now. They were not in, you know, comfort with each other, but for the survival of the government in the past 3 years after the death of late Chief Minister Jayalalitha. And OPS is considered the Deputy Chief Minister. O Panneerselvam is considered close to the BJP leadership. He went to Delhi when he rebelled against the present Chief Minister and met Narendra Modi, the Prime Minister, after which the governor of the then governor of Tamil Nadu, Mr. Vidyasagar Rao, you know, was then the swearing in ceremony of OPS was held, and they patched up together. So we cannot straight away say that the ADMK and BJP are really close in all ranks, but few people in the ADMK is close with the BJP. That is how it worked out. But in the recent past, in the last couple of months, if you take the denial in permission to the Vinayaka Chaturthi yatras as well, and recently about this particular Vetrivel yatra, the relationship has further strained. So we cannot say that they were very close. As we all know, late Jayalalitha was very close to Narendra Modi as well. But she defeated the BJP, and her only statement in that particular election was, "Do you want Modi or this lady?" That was the statement she made. So politically, they were not close to each other, but they had some personal connections maybe. So apart from that, the parties cannot be said that they were close. Only few leaders from this party and that party were close. That's all what we can say as far as the relationship is concerned now.
Right. And but nonetheless, it does seem that there is a strong possibility that they will continue to be allies in the coming elections.
Yeah, of course. That cannot be ruled out, because as far as ADMK is considered, we cannot rule out anything. They are also power hungry to some extent in the state. They are in power for the past almost 10 years now. So they want to continue. If they lose the future of the party, maybe, you know, party may be nothing in another 4 to 5 years. So to get some kind of votes, they may again, the ADMK may again ally with the BJP, compromising on their stance and all these present happenings. That may also happen. The BJP and ADMK may again contest the election together. We cannot rule out that probability also.
Right. And Nilamal, in this context, quickly just going through what is the current political mood in the state as well now, because elections are coming close by. It does look like the opposition alliance is fairly set. There is the DMK, the Congress, the VCK, the left parties. They have more or less established a fairly solid working relationship. The ruling side is in far more disarray, of course. But considering the pandemic and other issues, what is the general mood on the ground?
The opposition is, you know, united to a larger extent. They set an example for the rest of the country as well in the recent general elections as well. The BJP was decimated, and ADMK could win only one seat here. So they are putting up a united face. There are a lot of joint protests by all these parties. And the DMK is taking the leadership as well. They are, you know, conducting different meetings. Their virtual meetings are happening. Their leader is addressing all the meetings. So their ground level work has started. As far as the ADMK is concerned, they are not sure of their allies as yet. We cannot rule out again. As far as we can say that BJP will be fighting together with ADMK, we can also say that BJP may not fight with ADMK this time. The same is the case with the Patali Makkal Katchi, which is led by Dr. Andumani Ramadas. They fought the election together, the general election together, but the recent statements of their leadership is against the ADMK as well. So ADMK as of now is not sure who will fight with them together, whereas the ADMK, with the support of the left parties, the Congress, VCK, as you said, and MDMK as well, led by Mr. Vaiko, they are putting up an united face, and there were a little, you know, discussions in the alliance as regard as the number of seats they were going to contest. That was also put to rest after Stalin clarified that there is no problem with the alliance and we will speak with all the parties concerned to decide on that particular issue. The DMK even has started their propaganda works as well. Their election manifesto is being, you know, they are working on their manifesto as well. Whereas ADMK has not, you know, apart from announcing their chief ministerial candidate, nothing has happened technically, or more or less nothing has happened apart from that.
Right, right. So thank you so much, Nilambran, for talking to us. You'll be staying in touch in the coming weeks and months as the election scene heats up there.
Our next segment is part of an interview with Professor Praveen Jha of the Jawaharlal Nehru University. The last phase of polling for Bihar is scheduled for November 7th, and the opposition Mahagathbandhan has attracted a lot of attention by promising 10 lakh jobs. But if it does come to power, how is this alliance going to fund this promise? Professor Jha explains. We talked about the government and its various failings. Now, the opposition has a very ambitious agenda. They're promising a huge number of jobs. They're promising, of course, in a completely new model of development. How are they, what are the possibilities for financing this if they do come to power?
For a state like Bihar, which is very limited in terms of mobilization of resources, the challenges will continue to be huge. Because the architecture of resource mobilization in the country has changed for the worse. And there, as I said, GST played a terrible role. Right? In fact, the 10th Finance Commission had brought many areas in terms of, you know, raising resources, etc., within the ambit of state governments. What happened, yeah, with the GST was a real retrogression, right? So we need to keep that in mind. Okay, so broadly, you sort of are very constrained, very challenged, right? But you know, if we look at the choices which the state government has, any state government, of course, one is that you say, listen, FRBM is something which is hurting us quite a lot. So what has been done, for instance, in the context of the COVID pandemic, there was some rethink on that. Okay, that instead of 3, you can go up to 5, and you know, the provisions were outlined and so on. Again, conditionalities. I mean, the union government was behaving like as if it's the big brother and the, you know, like a landlord and so on. But I would argue that for many states which are lower down the development ladder, now there's nothing wrong in saying, okay, you can choose to have this kind of arrangement so that, you know, your resource kitty can be strengthened, right? But that's a huge political decision. Whether that happens or not, you know, is difficult to say, and one would be right in being pessimistic about it given the overall neoliberal climate, etc., right? Borrowing, so you know, you have to think of how to use your borrowed resources more judiciously. There could be some improvements there in terms of prioritizing, so you know, whether it is your social sectors or basic infrastructure, these could be pushed. You know, so for instance, good quality education not only creates good quality education, but it also creates huge employment, right? So you have a large number of young people, train them properly and so on. Why is that not being prioritized? Okay, so these things can be done. Then you have, and I am being very careful when I propose this, the option which had been foregone, which was given up in 2016 and I'm thinking of alcohol, right? What is this utterly, shall I say, retrogressive moralism which you want to impose on the state at large? So, can we think of taking care of that? Can we ask, and this only Bihar cannot do, as part of many other states, insist on, if you are not giving us anything else, at least give us a share in cess, which is our right. I mean, why is it that this cess becomes a right of the union government? So, these will have to be very important points of negotiation, right? And any progressive trajectory is, to my mind, almost impossible without some hard contestation, some difficult choices. So it would have to be a mixture of all that.
And that too, Bihar wouldn't be able to do it alone. It has to be a...
No, certainly not. So, but Bihar certainly can go back on its decision on prohibition. Yeah. And, you know, I talk to anyone from Bihar. Yeah. And it has become possibly one of the biggest illegal industries in that state. Now, do we want that? Right. If you want to enforce it, then that is a kind of expenditure, which itself is a extremely skewed kind of option, no? Yeah. Instead of having teachers, you want to have maybe 5 inspectors every village. Is that what we want to do? So, you know, I think possibilities are there. No easy options, sure enough. Yeah, I mean, of course, whatever slack is there in, let's say, resource utilization, I'm not talking of mobilization now, that again can be used. But yes, if we can do some of these things, I think it should be possible to move ahead. But the larger challenge is how to get a more progressive kind of federalism in place again. Yeah, to my mind, as I said earlier, you know, this GST was anti-constitution, and of course it has been adopted by all states, so now you can say that it has been passed, so how can you say this? But the spirit of constitution, I think this was completely against that. You know, very good arguments have been given why, as per the constitution, it was a disaster. And as an economic arrangement, I mean, there is nothing which can be claimed for it, to my mind. You know, it's all rhetoric. So, if you want to be in the happy world of Alice in Wonderland, so be it. Okay, but possibilities are there. They have to work much harder.
That's all we have time for today. We'll be back tomorrow with more news from the country. Until then, keep watching NewsClick. You